It'll be. There are a few changes. John Phelan is in goal. That's one change. Ivanovic retains his place at sweeper. Now there's a three-man back line in Durakovic, Tobin, and Marth. Andrew Marth comes into the side for the first time on the tour. Jason van Blerk will be on the left-hand side. And then the midfield will be from the right, Tapai, Wade, Peterson, Bozinowski. He comes back into the side after his match against the United States. And the Lone Ranger up front is Warren Spink. Looking at the Uruguayan lineup, that's as follows. Robert Siboldi is the goalkeeper. They line up in a 4-3-3 formation. The back line from the right is De Los Santos, Sanchez, Kanapkis and Cabrera. In the middle, Barrios, who's a real veteran, Saralegui and Salazar. And up front, Paz. That's not Ruben Paz, by the way. Larrea and Morena. And that's not Fernando Morena either. He's a cousin of the legendary Fernando, who has long retired. The referee for today will be Juan Carlos Lostao of Argentina. Well, firstly, Raul, let's have a little comment from you on the Australian lineup and the changes. It is a bit more defensive than before. He's got three stoppers there rather than two.
Not really. I think that what has happened in Uruguay is playing with three strikers. They're playing with two wide players, Paz and Morena, and one central striker, Larrea. And I think Eddie is putting Durakovic as a right fullback and Toby moves now as a left fullback. Yeah. I think what they're doing
so
is
three markers.
Three markers. Yeah. Plus Ivanovic as a sweeper.
Yeah, well, that's what I meant. So that's purely to counter the three-man strike line of the Uruguayans.
Yes.
And the rest, what's your comment on the rest of the lineup? Bozinowski comes back into the team. You've got Van Blerk wide on the left.
Yeah, well, Bozinowski will play as a central midfield with Wade and Peterson to combat this three midfield play formation that Uruguay have. And Tapai, Van Blerk, wide players, and Spin will be as a central striker.
John, your comments on the Aussie lineup?
Yeah, well, it's you pick your lineup according to the system the opposition play, and
sure.
that's Tobin, left full back, is no unusual position
no.
for him. That's where he grew up and learned all his football. Durakovic can play anywhere for mine in the defence. I still would like, my only question mark about the Australian team is this playmaker role in midfield, which I feel that if you only play with one in front, apart from the support from behind, you have to have someone in midfield who can hold the ball, not just to play it forward, because it'll come back quickly if you play it forward. And I really think we lack, and it's not against any of the players in any way, but we lack someone who can play in that position. Perhaps a Zelic is the answer, but that's the only disappointment for me. I would have liked perhaps to have seen Zelic given a longer spell in midfield. I know he's a fine player at the back, but I would like to see him more playing in midfield.
Raul, that's true, isn't it? I mean, Eddie Thompson does have a headache there in the playmaker situation. I know that he'd like to see Ned Zelic take that role because he has such good qualities. He's been toying around. Of course, Mickey Peterson has been the real candidate since Oscar Crino left the scene. Now, Bozinowski was tried against the United States. It's a real problem for him, isn't it?
Well, yes, but I think this is what he's trying to do, giving another chance to Vlado Bozinowski to see how he is going to perform. And Mike Peterson did a good job in that department, but I agree to a certain extent that that type of playmaker is the players we have. They are not really playmaker there. Ned Zelic in midfield. I think the way Ivanovic played last game against Argentina, I think it's a great chance that he will remain there and Zelic will come into midfield. Maybe Zelic could be the
even further down the track in the World Cup qualifiers.
I have an inclination to say so. Yes.
Okay. Thanks, Raul. Well, this is the third match, of course, on Australia's tour of the Americas. It all began in Orlando, in Florida, when Australia met the United States, one of the finest teams really around the world at this time. Let's have a look at the highlights of that again, with Australia in the yellow shirts, the United States in the white.
Now Marcelo Balboa, 17, the dummy run over it, now Murray, and it's just wide. Bruce Murray with a very authoritative strike of the ball, and that one didn't miss by much, Rick. Durakovic, number five. Back to Zelic. Now Blagojevic, number two. Nice ball through to the right side to Pai, number seven. Clavijo hurrying back. Far post. Chance for Aurelio Vidmar, and he just misses to protect the players on the field. Thrown in, flick back post, and Dodd gets up and punches it away from Vidmar. Aurelio Vidmar got up there, but Mark Dodd, with a good job, had to recover after the initial flick on and then push it away. Ball out for throw-in U.S. now. Unofficially, just under 19 minutes left on the stadium clock. They did stop the clock, by the way, during the lightning delay. Normally, of course, in the outdoor game, the clock runs. Quinn, a dipping shot, and diving is Zabika to push it out for corner kick. Free kick now, Australia. Chipped into the box, headed toward goal and in! Warren Spink puts Australia ahead with just over 5 minutes left.
Randy, decision-making is such an important part of the sport. On that particular goal, it seemed to be a little bit of indecisiveness, not only by the defensive part of the United States team, but also by the goalkeeper. Neither one really being convinced or certain as to what it is they're going to do. Defensive players not making the right play in terms of staying tight, and Mark Dodd getting caught in a half position.
Tackle administered. Quinn loses the ball. Armstrong back to get it for the U.S. Desmond Armstrong ahead for Quinn, led him a little far, but Stewart was there. Balboa shot! It's punched over for corner.
Marcelo holding his head there in despair. Here we'll see him receive the ball and then go to shoot it. The ball deflecting off of an Australian defender.
Balboa down to head this away, and then he gets the call, but that is the whistle to end the game. And Australia has upset the U.S. Cup champion, USA World Cup team.
Yes, well, the commentators there, by the way, were Rick Davis and Randy Hahn, in case you were wondering. Now, Raul Blanco, what about this Uruguayan lineup? There are some unfamiliar names here. I must point out that the manager, Cubilla, has not had a good time with the European-based players. They simply refused to play for him. So it's not a question of not picking them. But that's the side. What are your comments on the Uruguayan team?
Well, this is a team which I think is a new team in many ways. It's a really shame that Cubillas could not patch up the difference between himself and the European-based players, because I think it's going to stop everybody seeing Francescoli and Aguilera and Sosa, Herrera, and some great, great players. But nevertheless, they're a talented team in any case. I think young player Paz and Morena, two very intelligent players, two good players on the flanks. But they're really trying to. I think they are having this team just now because they have to patch up difference with the biggest stars they have in Europe.
Yes. Now, that 4-3-3 that they're using, is that the normal posture that they take, the Uruguayan team?
Yes, Uruguayan has been playing like this for a long, long period of time, as long as I remember. They don't play the twin stoppers. One becomes the sweeper. They pick according to wherever the strikers are. Always three midfield players, always one central midfield player, which is in front of the back four. And the three forwards up front, which one of the wide players always will drop into midfield a little bit.
Okay, Raul, thank you for that. Thank you, John. Let's go then to the Centenario Stadium in Montevideo. Our commentators are Andy Pascalidis and Peter Catholas.
And Australia get the chance today to finish this three-match tour of the Americas the way they started it as well. They started off with a win against the United States and, of course, losing to Argentina, a controversial penalty going against the Socceroos early in that second half. But today, the opportunity to redeem themselves and bounce back with a victory against a Uruguayan side which, despite being without several European-based players because of conflicts with the coach Luis Cubilla, they are still a formidable team lineup. And once again joining me is Peter Catholas. And Peter, we learned quite a lot from the Argentina game, and hopefully today we can do the job.
Yes, good morning, Andy. Yes, I think it should be an interesting game today, and hopefully the boys can get a few passes together and see a good game.
Four changes to the Socceroos today. Interesting ones at that. John Filan gets his first opportunity, as does Andrew Marth. Van Blerk starts a game, and Spink is back as well. Out as Abika, Bernal, Edwards and Blagojevic. And the Socceroos did in fact try to train on the Centenario Stadium yesterday, but the adverse weather conditions again, which dogged them on the first part of the tour, have come back again. And they couldn't train on the pitch, and then they had to go off to a second division ground and wait till that game was completed before they could get a run. Prior to that, they were training at the front of the team hotel on a barren bit of grass just outside the hotel, as John Filan gets what will be an important touch for the Wollongong City keeper, and of course the Olympic Games goalkeeper, who will be heading off to Barcelona. And obviously a tight battle for the goalkeeper's role, with Zabika in such good touch. This tap I had no chance whatsoever. Robin Simoldi, based in Mexico, the keeper, makes his debut today, and he was voted best foreign player in the Mexican competition last year. That's Salazar on the ball, Jose Luis Salazar, very talented player. And now Nelson Cabrera. As cool as ever is Jurakovic. And Vlado Bozanowski shows his feelings towards the Uruguayans. Crowd of around 20,000 in the Centenario Stadium in Montevideo. And this will be an extremely tight battle. And for those of you that can recall, Australia last played Uruguay back in April 1974. That was before, of course, the World Cup. It was a hit out for both countries. There was a nil-all draw in the first game and 2-0 in the second. And many of you will recall that Ray Barnes, that serious injury that he sustained in that match. And this is Australia's ninth match against South American opposition. And what a team to play. The world champions in 1930, 1950, Olympic champions twice in the 20s. And they've won the South American championship a record 14 times. Salazar tries his luck. A lovely save by John Filan. As early as the third minute, John Filan again shows us why he's rated one of the top keepers in Australia. And for his age in the world, I would think as well. The shot coming in from Salazar. Filan getting up there. A great save. So as early as the third minute, the Socceroos are under pressure. Juan Carlos Lostal is not happy with the balls, it seems. But a vital touch for the keeper.
It's a great save by John Filan. Great shot by the number 10, Salazar.
So now Van Blerk has to do some defensive work for Australia. Wade is over there as well. It's with Adrian Paz. No relation to his namesake. And as Les Murray had mentioned earlier, Claudio Morena, his uncle, had played against the Australians in 74. Wade is over there again. He's so strong in the air. But the pressure is right on the Australians, although Tapai had an easy steal. But as you can see, the conditions are very difficult out there. And I would suspect there'll be a lot of sliding going around there, as Jurakovic back in the right back position today, feeding it on for Van Blerk. Now Mike Peterson. Vlado Bozanowski is also back at the team. In comes across from Jurakovic, a deep ball. Wade, the header! Off the bar! How close! Australia get the rebound! And Spink with a chance to put Australia ahead.
What a move.
And Paul Wade, as he had done against Sweden in that third game in Melbourne, it looked like it was on for the captain. Great touch on by the keeper, then Spink. Although I would suspect Tapai would have been declared offside. And what a comeback by the Australians. And at the other end, Uruguay try their luck.
But a great start to the game, Peter.
What a great move there. Great passage of play there, and Wade coming on the far post with a great header. So unlucky for Australia there.
And Paul Wade, and just seconds earlier, the captain was back in the area helping his defence. And a lovely move by the Australians. And it was interesting to note that Jurakovic was involved. So Jurakovic filling the role of Milan Blagojevic. And Milan delighted with his contribution to this tour. He didn't expect to get too many runs, but he did the job in the first two games. There's a good, strong, forceful header away, Spink. Yeah, well, Spink was held back. The referee allows the advantage. Wade inside to Peterson. He looks for the runner in Van Blerk. But the numbers are back there for Uruguay. Plenty of cover. Good recovering work from the Uruguayan defence. Marena loses out this time, though, to Tapai. Now Peterson trying to get it on for either Wade. The referee right on the spot.
Much better start than the game against Argentina. Much more confident, and it's looking good for the Australian boys.
It certainly is. The commitment is there, as you would expect from any Australian side. And I'm sure that that chance for Wade would have given the team an extra bit. Confidence would have picked up somewhat. Nice turn inside by Peterson, but he was clipped on the way through. And again, the referee very quick with his decision. Saraligi was the culprit on that occasion. Milan Ivanovic and Vlado Bozanowski. There was no chance at all for the Australians to do anything there. And we were talking earlier about the conflict between the national coach Rubia and his European stars. Well, he's got the likes of Sosa Aguilera, Francescoli, Pereira, Fonseca, and Herrera as well. So, you know, he's got a lot of players that he could call on, but he's deciding to stick with those faithful that have stayed in Uruguay, or the likes of Siboldi, who's playing in Mexico. Although I should point out that Salazar, he plays in Spain with Albacete. And on the ball at the moment is Nelson Cabrera. Marf will get there first, though, for Australia, ahead of Larea, the number nine, making his debut for Uruguay today. Cabrera with a throw-in. Played in that 1-0 win against Brazil. In fact, 6 of the 11 out there for Uruguay played against Brazil last April. And Uruguay got up in that game by 1-0. So, naturally, they're not short of talent, this Uruguayan side, despite missing key players in Europe. Same could be said for the Australians as well. Cheeky little run from Spink. Now Peterson. Good switch. Jurakovic getting involved in the attacks early. Nice turn inside. Never Jurakovic looking for support. There was some coming through in the form of Spink. But a great start by Australia. Almost 9 minutes up, and the Australians are taking the game to the Uruguayans.
Fantastic play. They're settling down the game really well, putting a lot of passes together. And again, Jurakovic with a great cross. This is good, confident play.
And it's good for Australia to have the likes of Jurakovic. He can play anywhere in the defence. He can play in the midfield as well. It's good to have those players who can you can slot in anywhere.
Of course, Andy.
I think in terms of our defence, we've got a lot of backup there. Maybe the midfield has let us down on this tour, but the chances out there for a few players to stand up and be counted, the likes of Peterson, Bozanowski. They've all got points to prove to the national coach, Eddie Thompson.
Well, it's good to see Bozanowski and Peterson in the moves in those plays there. They're more involved today than the previous games.
So it is 10 minutes up. As yet no score. Wade again back there to cover. Bozanowski across for Jason Van Blerk, and his future somewhat in doubt, you could say. The Apia attacking midfielder. Although word hasn't come through as to whether Ron Orsani's consortium will get the go-ahead or more Falcons will be promoted. But there was a significant announcement on Saturday night from ASF headquarters in Sydney that the banning of ethnic names will come into force in the National League. And that follows hot on the heels of the New South Wales Federation steps as well. And the young Socceroos had a hit out on Saturday against the Irish club side Shelbourne, ended in a 0-0 draw. And now Uruguay, but again Milan Ivanovic, he read the situation well, didn't commit himself too early and just waited for the mistake, you could say, from the Uruguayan. And good covering work from De Los Santos, just his fourth cap. And Uruguay is such a strong nation in the world of football. They're a small country really with a population of New Zealand, yet a world power in soccer since the 20s. And there's so many players overseas, that's because of depressed economic conditions in Uruguay, and it's understandable that they want to make life better for themselves and head to Europe. It could be a sticking by the faithful, the likes of Morena, the number 11. And already a lot of long balls played by both teams, you could say. Tapai, rode the challenge of Cabrera, now Mehmet Jurakovic. Good dummy by Spink, Peterson in possession. And against, well, Peterson's been fouled twice in the last few minutes. That time the heels just clipped. Peterson, the second longest serving player in the 11 there today. Of course, Wade has played now. This is his 49th A international. And Peterson's 27. Robert Sebaldi, the keeper for Uruguay. Great touch on against the bar, that forceful Wade header. But he'll have some work to do there. Can Australia take advantage? They can't this time. There's plenty of numbers back for Uruguay. And good pressuring work from the Australians. They're closing them down in the midfield. They're not giving them too much space and forcing them into error. It's good to see from Australia. This is shaping up as a top game, Peter. Much better than the first two.
Absolutely, Andy. I mean, a good start, great start. And we're taking the game to them. We're getting forward. And we're you know, controlling the play.
Although an uncharacteristic error, and Filon got down well to deny Larre.
Certainly not
that there. That was a surprise, really. But Filon again positioned himself well, got down. And a good save by the Australian keeper. Martha crosses Bozanowski. And it looked like Zalazar had committed a foul, but the referee has picked it up. And the South Melbourne defender knocks it down the line. Cleared away again by Cabrera. And having a chat with the Australian camp the last couple of days, that they are absolutely fired up for this game, but they can't wait to get home as well. They've done so much travelling. Started in Sydney, they were delayed actually for 3 or 4 hours. They ended up in Auckland, they were delayed there. They headed off to Buenos Aires, then Montevideo. They were fogged in there, back to Buenos Aires, then Miami, and then they stopped on the way through to Miami at Venezuela before heading off to Florida for the USA game, and then back to Buenos Aires via New York for the Argentinian game. So as they told me, the Leyland brothers have got nothing on them on this tour.
What was that again, Andy?
The Leyland brothers have got nothing on them on this tour. Good break by Uruguay. Barrios, the experienced veteran. A layoff now on the shot. It took a deflection off one of the Socceroo defenders. And thankfully for John Filon, there was no work for him to do there, but there will be soon, I suspect. Good play by Uruguay. Good interchange passing.
Yeah, they're settling down. I mean, we don't want to give them the opportunity to settle down and play like that, because they'll take us apart that way.
And it comes, plenty of support at the near post. Although Mladenovic was so involved in that initial build-up, he was waiting. So it's good to see that both teams are throwing men forward at every occasion, trying to break the deadlock, not being too negative. And the Uruguayan coach, Luis Cubilla, had actually headed across and watched Australia play Argentina. He was impressed as well. And actually showed his concern about the standard of opposition just to make the trip across. He was particularly impressed by the Australians' toughness. And perhaps they don't come any tougher than Andrew Marr from the centre of that Australian defence. And Moreno was taken out by Bozanowski. Referee having a few words to say to Vlado Bozanowski. Made his debut back in 88 against Brazil. Van Blerk has no trouble intercepting inside his way. Now Spink. And then releasing it for Van Blerk. Although De Los Santos had plenty of time to get across.
For our viewers that follow Greek First Division, Andy, Gorgi Barrios also played for Olympiakos in 85-86. So he's had plenty of international experience.
That was the time you were at Larissa, was it, around that time?
Yes.
Big player in Greece at the time?
Yes, he was. He was one of the biggest transfers at that time.
There he is on the screen, the captain of Uruguay. Jorge Barrios, 0-0 is the score. We've had just on 17 minutes. And I don't think fans can complain about the standard of the play today. Both teams eager to test each defence. And as you notice there, Alex Tobin was held back, and the left-back position is the position Tobin started off with at Adelaide City. And like Sabika and the rest of his Adelaide City teammates, a big year for them. And I suspect Phelan will try to play it long. Phelan also one of the Oli Roos that has been looked at by some European clubs. And I suspect that many of our Olympic side will head overseas once they finish their commitments in Barcelona. Van Blerk down the line for Spink. Wade is inside if he wants him. Turned by Spink, Van Blerk on his left. And it's not a bad ball inside, headed on. Tapoy was up, but no power behind that header. And behind Tapoy was Jurakovic, but a good move by Australia. And it might be on again. Peterson was fouled by the captain, Barrios. And they seem to have singled out Mike Peterson as the playmaker, perhaps trying to block his supply to our attack.
For sure, for sure. I'm impressed by Warren Spink's start. He's really giving him a bit of trouble. He's controlling the ball really well and lay off effective passes.
Spink would be on a high after that goal against the United States. Great goal it was. The header on by Bozanowski in the snapshot on the turn. What a try.
Great shot.
And a good opportunity for Australia. It seemed to come from nothing and it's taken a deflection. Well, what a start for Australia. Luis Cubilla, you can understand why he's puffing on a cigarette. He'd be very concerned about the way his defence has started this game. I wasn't too sure who had the shot on the turn. I thought it might have been Spink. But either way, Australia are in a good situation right now. Mike Peterson takes the corner. The keeper was thinking about it. Up was Marth. But the numbers are back there. Larea is clearing it away. And the ball on, a good header on, and then it was Wade as well. Keeper had no trouble in the end. But a very, very confident start. We've had just on 20 minutes.
This is good to see. We're taking the game to the Uruguayan team, and that we're not sort of sitting back and and let them dictate play, which is good to see from Australia.
And this defence, relatively young in terms of international experience. None of the defenders have played more than seven or eight caps in their country. The most experienced player out there naturally is Barrios, the captain, the number eight. He made his debut back in 79 in the Copa. Upkiss back inside for Zalazar, player to look out for. Zalazar was voted man of the match against Brazil. He's on the ball at the moment, the number 10. Switch across. Support inside in Morena. This is a lovely move, and the keeper was there again. Larea was the man chasing. And you can see a system already working out between Zalazar and Larea.
Salazar, well, he's their playmaker. He looks a very well-balanced player, very skillful player, and he is the one that accounting for the organisation of the play.
And he's coming out of a fairly good season with Albacete in Spain, Salazar. Ivanovic now for Marth. I suppose the other aspect in this game, Peter, the fact that coming into the tour, a lot of our players were limited in terms of match fitness, and I think that their performances so far, particularly their conditioning and so on, their fitness levels have been pretty good considering.
Yes, I agree with you, Andy. It's fitness levels are quite high considering we haven't played for so long. I think a couple of more games under our belts we would look very, very effective.
Barrios has to organise his team for this corner kick. Los Santos and Saraligi on the line. Buzz in front of his keeper. In it comes from Peterson. Keeper again was thinking about it. And that back post, Paul, seems to be the right one for Australia. The big men are coming up, the likes of Marth and Wade as well. And the keeper's been in two minds as to whether he should come out or not. So perhaps that'll be the pattern with the free kicks and the corner kicks.
Well, absolutely. We've had a few corners now. We've had more corners than they have. So, you know, we're the ones doing all the attacking at the moment.
Well, we're midway through the first half. No goals as yet, but opportunities at both ends. And enough for both teams to be enthused about. As Ivanovic's clearance, a hasty one, given away. Barrios, he's given it away, and then Van Blerk did the same as well. So some mistakes just creeping in there. Larea getting it back, and the header not forceful enough to test Filan, but I suspect that Eddie Thompson will not be happy with his defence there, because they didn't pick up.
No one was picking up Salazar there. It was a Salazar.
The cross comes in, and the free header. Look like Larea. And this Centenario Stadium is one of the most famous football landmarks in the world. It was built actually for the 1930 World Cup, the very first World Cup. It was opened on the 100th birthday of the independence of Uruguay from Spain. That's why it's called Centenario. That means centenary in English. And can they rejoice here with a nice dazzling solo run coming in? But inside waiting was Larea, and I just suspect that Adrian Paz would have been maybe better off to knock it square. But the old adrenaline rush when you make a run like that, you think, well, the goal's there, maybe I should go for it.
Good skill there. He took the player on there, beat him quite easily.
Well, another stoppage in Van Blerk. He's down at the moment.
Yeah. also a big game for Van Vleuten today. I think he's his first full international, I'm not sure, but certainly a big game for Jason.
Jason's first appearance, he scored two goals. Luis Cubilla, El Gordo, the fat one. He's a former great player, actually, in the 60s and early 70s. He was in Spain. And he created a few. There's Dr. Brian Corrigan, Les Scheinfeld and Eddie Thompson. Smiles on the Aussie bench. They look quite dazzling in those new tracksuits.
Yes, look quite smart.
Mike Peterson again. Siboldi double checks with his defence. In comes the free kick. Looking for Wade. They're not on at the back post. No one there though. Paul Wade winning quite a bit of ball in the air, as you would expect. That's one of his strengths.
Yes, he's very, very good in the air, Paul Wade, and Mike Peterson is always looking for him in the far post.
Not a very good clearance by Siboldi. He's actually making his debut today. Outstanding keeper. Playing in Mexico, and I recall Chris Hummel made a move to Mexico and things fell through there. The former young Socceroo keeper as well tried his luck there. And there'll be no chance for Uruguay. Almost 27 minutes into this game, as yet no score. Last night there was heavy rain, thunderstorms out in the sea. And it looked like again there could have been some trouble for this game to be played here, although there was no fog during the week. La Rega was held back.
Yeah, not impressed with Uruguay. Seems to me like Zalazar and Paz are the only two players that are probably class players in this side. They're certainly not the Uruguay that we all know of.
And I think a lot of reason behind that is the fact that the Australians aren't giving them much room to play, although in the last 5 minutes some of their attacks have looked very threatening. Tapai, we haven't seen much of him today. And the captain, the experience showing out. Salazar's ball inside. There was a foul against Milan Ivanovic. Larella is the man who's down. And John Farren, as you can see, organising Peterson and Bozanowski in that wall.
That's a sign of a good goalkeeper, talking to his players there.
Zalazar, the number 10. Man of the match against Brazil. He'll probably try it from here. He does. Well worth the try as well. Not a bad attempt.
He's got a very strong shot on him. He's very well built.
Great experience for the Socceroos. South American tour. And of course, the game against the United States. The standard of opposition to test themselves against, and hopefully the Socceroos will be able to get through to play the World Cup qualifier in South America. The right to make it to the USA. And Bozanowski getting stuck in. And Upkus, not too impressed with Bozanowski's style of play, you could say. But it started earlier, really, because both Bozanowski and one of the other Uruguayan players were fighting for possession and they weren't holding back. Good to see the referee right in the thick of the action. Total control from the referee, Juan Carlos Gustao, an Argentinian. And again, Salazar. No real threat at all for John Filan. 15 minutes left in the game, and no goals as yet. Minutes into this first half. 0-0's the score, and Australia, the best chance in the fifth minute of the game when Paul Wade, a strong header, struck the crossbar after the keeper. Sibaldi got an important deflection. It was a great save by the keeper, and the rebound by Spink was saved again by Sibaldi, although Tapai was in an offside position, and I suspect if the ball went in, the referee wouldn't have given the goal. Martha Wade, good control by Zanoski. Tapai surrounded by the Uruguayan players as Marth played the first time ball. Wade back on for Wade from Van Blerk, and perhaps I thought the captain was flat-footed there, not expecting the pass.
Just a
Wade
bit
gets
too
the
hard
ball
for him
inside
there.
And
just a little bit too hard there.
It was a bit hard from Van Blerk, wasn't it? But still Australia. Tapai, not a good cross from him, surprisingly. Peterson. And well, confusion there, Kanapkis and the keeper. And not too sure, Robert Sibaldi's making his debut today, but maybe he's feeling a bit tentative in goal. He's not really come out in a confident manner for those sorts of balls. But again, Australia having, well, you could say the half chance to try and break through.
Just laid a little bit hard there. It was a little bit softer. It could have been a great chance.
Van Blerk again in the thick of the action. And as you noticed as he went down there, the water is pretty heavy out there. It rained yesterday. And the Socceroos weren't allowed to train on the pitch. It's Peterson again. Sibaldi ready. Wade's up there, and a missed kick, and it could have fallen for Spink. But the Uruguayan defence is looking fairly shaky, surprisingly, as well. And Australia getting right into it.
We're playing really well. I mean, away from home in Uruguay, Montevideo, it's quite a good performance, quite a first half performance.
I'm sure Eddie Thompson would be happy, although he's probably thinking some of those half chances. Tad unlucky not to put one of those away. A nice touch on inside for Wade. The midfield's really firing today for Australia. Good ball inside. Spink, he tries the snapshot. And just maybe Spink could have gone on with it there. I thought he's got the measure on the defence. He's pretty fast. But not a bad idea from Spink, trying to catch the keeper off guard. He looked up earlier and he saw the keeper's off his line, maybe trying to put it over the keeper. But nonetheless, promising signs for Australia.
Very encouraging. We're coming forward today's game, and we're creating plenty of opportunities.
And the Socceroos look much more hungrier than the game against Argentina.
I don't know if it's hungry. I think they're more comfortable. That game against Argentina would have done their confidence great.
A lot of good.
A lot of good, definitely.
And I think the fact that the Socceroos have so much possession today, more time on the ball, gives you much more confidence as well.
Well, of course, I mean, if you've got the ball, you can dictate the play, and this is very important for winning games.
The last 10 or 15 minutes, Juraković really hasn't had the opportunity to come down that right side. But a lot of the attacks have been generated from the midfield. The likes of Peterson and Wade and Bozanowski getting involved. Wade is playing like a striker the last 5 or 10 minutes. Is that deep? Good interception by Tapai. Marth. Well, there was a blatant foul on that occasion against Tapai. And in recent times, Ernie Tapai has made that wide midfield position his own in the Australian team after, and we should point out, Tapai made his debut back in 1986. And it's been 6 years since he's really cemented that position.
Well, he's quite fast and he takes players on quite well and he puts a good crossover, so it's not surprising.
And there's a lesson for not just the Socceroo team, but teams all around the world. Way to enforce that offside trap. Uruguayans, just all of them ran out together in unison, and six Australians caught offside. And there's the ball on for Larea. Martha again over there for Australia. What an amazing recovery it's been from Andrew Marth. Had knee injury, then he played a part in the top five playoffs of the Coca-Cola Soccer League. And he snatched a place in for the tour. Well, the referee has allowed play to continue? No, I don't think so.
In fact, it's been quite a good performance from Andrew Marth. He's marked Larea out of the game totally. We haven't seen him at all.
And again, Salazar, a fairly identical position as the shot that he had in the 29th minute. This time getting right underneath it, a good decoy run, but couldn't bend it around the wall into that top left-hand corner of Fyland's goal. We've noticed at Euro 92, a lot of the keepers have, I don't know whether they've had too many men in the wall or they just haven't positioned themselves properly, but a lot of goals have come from free kicks in similar situations.
Yeah, absolutely. The one this morning was nowhere different.
Weighed up yet again. And now Marth. Touch on by the captain, Wade, and he was good decision. He was fouled just as he went for the ball. And the referee right on the spot again. Spink leaving it for Tapai. Wozniowski now, Tapai again. Here comes the cross, and again confusion between Kanapkis and the keeper, Siboldi. Kanapkis had obviously made up his mind he was heading it away, even though Siboldi was calling out for it. But Australia should try and take as best advantage as they can out of the well, lack of communication between the keeper and his defence. Uruguay have won the South American Championship 14 times. That's a record as well. That's more than Argentina and Brazil combined. And a good take by the keeper, Siboldi. Stole a few steps, but nonetheless, a lot of the keepers do it these days. They don't seem to enforce the law in South America as they do in other parts of the world.
Certainly don't.
Well, that's much better play from Uruguay, although there's plenty of reinforcements in the Australian defence. And Gluck has come across from the left midfield position. Larea was playing for the free kick all the time and he gets it. Smart play by Larea. So we're approaching the 40th minute mark in this game. Is it no score? And John Fallon calling Van Bloek back into that two-man wall. And the shot well blocked. And Catwell, whether it was intentional from Peterson, it did the job. Now Spink looks for support, finds it. in the form of Peterson, who's still a bit groggy after that that ball. But it's 0-0, five to go in the first half. Good, enterprising first 40 minutes.
Well, Andy, we're knocking the ball around quite well. The boys seem a lot more comfortable than the other day.
Captain Barrios trying to fire up his team. Desperate for the breakthrough as De Los Santos knocks it long again. Marth slipping a tad, and Ivanovic blocks out Larea. He keeps his cool under pressure all the time, Milan Ivanovic. Adrian Paz can't get past Tobin. Cabrera. And Barrios still has possession for his team, Uruguay. A late challenge from Drakovic, and I must say, Canamkes rode the challenge well. Cabrera taken out. And Australia will have to be ready at this stage. There's just on 3 minutes of normal time left. They wouldn't want to concede a goal in such a critical period of the game.
This is the worst time to concede a goal. We're going to be careful, very careful here.
Salazar will take the free kick again, as he's done throughout the first half. And well, Fyden was scrambling for it, and the header was off target, and it looked like it was Larea, but it's taken a touch. It must have come off one of the socceroos. I thought that the way it was swinging around, that it might have come off Larea. But again, the Australian defence have to cover, and a good take by Fyden.
A good take. Yeah,
that was a much better take, because he was really struggling to get across to that first one. The free kick from Salazar. And Salazar it is, getting it across. Canapkis leaving it. De Los Santos knocking it on. Paz, and here it is again with Salazar. Key player for his team today. Great skill, superb play. And then Bozanowski commits the foul again. Jose Luis Salazar, the number 10. Not a good free kick from him this time. Oh, a lovely flick on for Tapai. Wade's in the centre if he wants him. Wade's on if he can get it through. A good recovery work. De Los Santos was the man for Uruguay. And Wade seems to be playing like a striker.
He certainly
is. 15, 20 minutes.
It's very good to see Paul Wade making those forward runs from midfield. He'll be causing a lot of problems to the Uruguayan defence.
We're into the last minute of normal time in the first half. No goals as yet. And I don't think too much time will be added on for stoppages. Saraligi looking for Paz. But a good start to this game. Good first half performance from Australia. Just one or two occasions where there's been errors at the back. Fyden has only had to make the one clear-cut save.
But the referees' decisions are quite on the spot, Andy.
Peterson. And there, in fact, it is. Just 5 seconds added on. a good first half for both teams. I think Uruguay came back into the game towards the latter stages, but a superb start for Australia.
Absolutely, a great half by Australia. We've taken the game to them, we've controlled play, we've created chances, and it's very encouraging to see that.
Well, there's certainly plenty of goal mouth action during the first half, and I'm sure that our panellists Johnny Warren, Liz Murray and Raul Blanco will have plenty to talk about. So at half time, from the Centenario Stadium in Montevideo, Australia 0, Uruguay 0.
Thank you, Andy Paskalidis and Peter Katholis. And, fellas, a very good first half from an Australian point of view. Raul, real cultured football and some lovely chances too.
Yeah, the best game to date. Obviously, as we discussed before, they were a little rusty against United States. I think the Argentina game gave them maybe this sharpness and cohesion that it was lacking. But I think now they're playing the best game of the two.
I mean, they played very well against the United States too, didn't they, John? But somehow the penetration wasn't there. There is penetration there today.
There is, the fluency's there, and I think you have to say that the opposition is probably better than in the United States. And some many good individual performances. Les Spink doing well up front. Ivanovic is at the back as usual. Wadey having probably his best game for some time. But it's good to see the Australian team play what I call, quote unquote, the Australian style, to take the game to the opposition, even if you're away from home. And I think this has probably put Uruguay off a little bit. And perhaps second half they're going to have to readjust a little bit. I'm sure they'll sort it out at half time. But it is a natural instinct to go at opponents rather than to sit back. It just doesn't suit our mentality or our style.
And that's happening today. Well, we've got some highlights from the first half for you, which are not quite ready for us. But the defence doing its stuff, John, with the three strikers knocking them off. Let's have a look at these highlights.
Well, this was the first opportunity, and it's a good move. It indicates the fluency of the Australian game. Good build up wide. Cross from Tapai and the header from Wadey, which Cibaldi gets a touch to it, luckily, otherwise that would have been 1-0 for Australia.
That was a very good move because it was a lot of touches and they're looking very confident on the ball.
Djurakovic in an attacking role there.
Djurakovic, that role on the right is suiting him.
Djurakovic can play almost anywhere, but I think he's playing very well as a right full back. He's very quick, he can overlap, and he's a very good player on the ball too.
That was one of the few mistakes Australia made defensively in the first half, and nearly paid the price for it. Tobin on the left, as usual. His safe self, very clean, don't see his opponent.
Well, this is again where Australia came quite close. There was a volley later on which we were hoping to show you where Australia came very close, and then there were chances further on. So I think that Thomas obviously would be happy. I doubt very much whether he'd make any sort of changes.
I don't think so. I think that having Van Blerk and Tapai both playing wide, and it's allowing Paul White to come from behind much more, and Paul White has almost been a striker many occasions. And I agree with John. They're playing really in a very positive way. They're taking the game to Uruguay. And it's been a very good match and a very even match, which I speak really highly about our performance, because Uruguay is a nation which we all have to respect very much. I mean, it's a great soccer nation.
I like the role that Spink is playing too in this one, that he's not just standing there as the Lone Ranger, but he's making a lot of decoy runs and taking players with him, allowing them. And I think, John, finally, we're beginning to see perhaps the midfielders running into those positions.
Yeah, there's been a lot of support today. They've been active, haven't they? They've been mobile, they've been in the game. Tapai, Wade, Peterson has been a marked man, hasn't he? They've certainly earmarked him as the playmaker. They've given him a bit of treatment. Bojanowski is a player I'd like to see a little bit more of. He's got the experience and the background to probably contribute a little bit more than he's doing so far.
Raul?
Yes, I agree. I think that in the second half we see if we keep this pattern that we are having. I think this is why Spink is playing much better today. A lot of players around him and he can really enjoy himself a bit more. But I think that Bojanowski is playing quite well too. I think he's been the tackling very hard, and he's been winning the ball quite a bit. And it's not easy to play against Uruguay midfielder. I'm very impressed with Salazar, number 10, really look a class
They closed down well. What about that playmaker problem we were referring to earlier? That's not a problem at the moment?
I don't think so. I think that because Wade is so involved and Peterson is involved and Tapa is involved, I think that it's been a better team performance all around. And this, I think this schema that we were talking about, the playmaker, I don't think it's needed as much today, because it's very much involvement by everybody else in the team.
Okay, well, they're almost ready to go in Montevideo for the second half. Remember that in the semi-final of the European Championship this morning, Germany defeated Sweden 3-2 there in the final on Saturday morning. And tomorrow morning, it'll be the Netherlands against Denmark in the second semi-final. And so off we go for the second half. Commentator is Andy Paskalidis and Peter Katholos.
Well, Australia last played Uruguay back in 1974, and that resulted in two matches, 0-0 in Melbourne and 2-0 in Sydney, and Ray Bartz and Peter Ollerton were the scorers on that day. And the soccer media around the world refused to believe that scoreline. So today Australia again gets the opportunity to keep the slate clean, maintain their unbeaten run as a change has been made. Sergio Martinez has come on, and it looks like Morena is the man who's come off. Doesn't appear to be any changes to the Socceroo lineup. Although Alistair Edwards was warming up during the break. So Australia doing well against Uruguay in 74. And it's been a long time since then, since we've played the Uruguayans, and there is some talk that perhaps Uruguay might tour Australia in the future. No goals as yet, but as you would have noticed if you'd followed the game from the start, there was opportunities at both ends. And we're underway again, so Martinez coming on for Morena. That's an interesting change. Martinez is a striker as well. This is his ninth international. And just having a good look around, no changes it appears to the Australian side, as Filan gets the ball away. So the last 45 minutes of the tour, Peter, and it's a 45 minutes. Australia obviously will be hoping to finish on a high note like they did against the Americans.
For sure. I mean, if we continue to play like we played in the first half, I think it's going to be very encouraging for Australia.
By it looks like on that far side, Bozanowski, Mr. Vlado Bozanowski. And I'm not too sure where Bozanowski will be heading off to, whether he'll be staying in Portugal. I've got some news actually come through yesterday that Graham Arnold, the Socceroo, is heading off to Belgium to play with FC Liège as Wade again. Well, Paul Wade is having an absolutely outstanding match. Every ball he's climbed for, he seems to get there ahead. Although on that occasion, Daniel Sanchez was keeping close tabs on him.
Seems he's playing like a centre forward today.
But just the pressure alone from Wade is doing outstanding things for Australia at the moment. Adrian Paz and Van Blerk, he's a pretty fleet-footed sort of customer as well. Tapai. In the end, Tapai, I think, concedes the free kick against Saraligi. Marcelo Saraligi, the outstanding midfielder, he's only 20 years of age. Number 5 is in the Olympic team. They finished third in their group. Scored 4 goals this year, actually, with the Olympic team. Now Peterson, Wade, Van Blerk will switch. Rosanowski tapped by down the line, but
Good interception coming in from, I think it was Cabrera. Peterson, good control. Good confident play by Australia. Van Blerk. Tap by. And just too far for Spink.
There seems to be more urgency. Uruguayans have come out very hungry second half, it looks like to me. Maybe the coach has had a few words to him half time.
De Los Santos inside for Barrios. And now Daniel Sanchez back. Sanchez and Barrios, the veterans of this team, both 30 years of age. Big clearance by Siboldi Wade. Perseverance. Zanoski inside, Van Blerk. Did well to keep it in, but there was plenty of numbers there for Uruguay. Well, that was a pretty dangerous challenge from the captain, Barrios. And that's what the referees pulled up play for. And Juan Carlos Ustal, the Argentinian, having an outstanding game, really. Nothing controversial. Always on the spot. But not on by Spink. Tapai. Too much meat behind it, right over the top. And of course, Australia, once they return, some of the players in the Olympic team will head into camp. The Olympic team have been in camp in Sydney along with the Australian youth team. And the Olympic team will head off early next month to play in Europe before heading off to Barcelona. And while they're touring, Australia will be playing three matches against the national Croatian team on the 5th of July in Melbourne, then midweek in Adelaide, and then the following Sunday on the 12th in Sydney. So still a busy schedule for our national teams.
Absolutely. The boys have got no break whatsoever.
And by that time, it'll be pre-season training, I would suspect, for quite a few teams. Tobin keeping his cool, but possession given away. Ivanovic didn't get the number on Saraligi. Zalazar fed it across, good interception by Tapai. Peterson's made a run in the middle, looking for Spink. He's onside, but the keeper comes out. And good confident play by the Uruguayan keeper. Can Tapai keep it in? He does. Tapai is there on the ball rather at the moment. Now Wade, Peterson, and too much behind that one. But Australia not overawed by the occasion out there, away from home against a team that's got one of the best reputations, not just in South America, but in world football as well.
Absolutely, Andy. This is a great performance. We're coming forward, like we said, on numerous occasions. And it's been a very positive performance today.
Committed challenge from Mehmet Durakovic. Peterson's made the run through the centre and just offside. And if he just held back, he would have been through too. And he gets a yellow for clearing the ball away. And for youngsters around the country, I'm sure that your coaches have told you, you just don't do that. And that, in fact, is the first yellow. So Australia picking up where they left off in the first half. Fernando Canapkes had blocked that intended pass from that right-hand side. Wade, Durakovic, now Peterson. Cross, just not the right sort of cross from Australia. I think it was Bosanowski. There's a nice ball inside. Saraligi has found his man now in Adrian Buzz.
Great tackle.
Very, very good tackle. The Australian defence keeps its cool under pressure so many times. You've seen it, not just in this game, but in previous internationals.
We have defended very well. And clean defending, my ad. No fouls.
Can't afford to give those fouls away in that defensive third, particularly against South American opposition. And that touch on by Wade, it just looked like Spink might have been on his way through. And that was a good, strong, clean challenge by Djurakovic, although it, well, a bit of a skirmish there between Bardios and Wade. And sadly, a bit of spite creeping in, and Wade's definitely not that sort of player. The Argentinian referee putting his foot right down. It's been a good clean match so far, really. The referee allows play to continue, and there was no foul there at all as Djurakovic came in again. The commitment there, typical Australian commitment in the defence at the moment. But Uruguay, it's good play by them up until that stage there. Wade leaves it for Peterson. Some mistakes creeping in for both teams. Salazar, good strong run. Saraligi lays it off for De Los Santos. Salazar, Saraligi, Ivanovic there for Australia. They've got to get it away though. Djurakovic tries his best. And the touch on, just wide too. And it looked like Salazar at that near post just got his boot to it. And we'll see on the replay, Australia for the first time really not clearing it away. Djurakovic was always struggling to get across there, and it looked like it took a touch.
Good passage of play by the Uruguayans. They put a couple of passes together. Good cross.
And Uruguay certainly have been jolted into action during that halftime break, and imagine what Luis Cabrillo had said to his players. As that cross comes in, no worries at all for John Phelan, but Uruguay are certainly taking hold at the moment.
Well, a nil-nil result for them is, you know, it's embarrassing in front of their own home crowd, so the pressure's on them to really give something to their supporters.
And their supporters really haven't come out in force in the past because of the fact that the overseas-based players haven't played. There was only about 15,000 when they played here back in April, on the 30th of April, and they beat Brazil 1-0. There's about 20,000 there today. Bozanowski. Tap by. And Peterson back from Wade. Djurakovic. Djurakovic will get in there as he does. But it falls straight to Kanapkis. Ivanovic back for Australia. Djurakovic. Wade gave up his job as a draftsman to work as a development officer with the Victorian Soccer Federation. He was telling me how easy the job is, particularly after the Olly Roos result against Holland. That two-week period after that game, Paul said that he didn't have to spread the gospel that much because the public of Australia knew what the team was about and what they'd done and what they'd achieved. Like anything, it's the senior team that we have to sell more so than the other teams. They are all important in that.
It's fantastic for Australia. The Olly Roos qualifying for the Barcelona Games.
But this series is an important one for Australian football, particularly considering we face Croatia then later on in September, the World Cup qualifiers start. Spink
Can he get past Cabrera, Spink? Not enough meat behind it. The keeper had to get down, but...
He has looked so lively, Andy, today. Him and Tapai have been first class.
Saraligi had got the touch on. He's in possession at the moment. Saraligi come up through the ranks in the youth team, the Olympic team this year. This is his eighth international with the senior team. Exciting prospect, midfielder. Farland again. He was looking for Wade. Well, surely Wade was climbed on by Daniel Sanchez. Tobin down the line. And Spink just clipped by Saraligi.
Good decision there. I think the Socceroos have gained a lot of respect, Andy, in the, you know, in those South American countries by the results. I mean, although we lost to Argentina, we did really well in today's performance. I think we're gaining a lot of respect.
And Bozanowski tries his luck, and it wasn't too far wide at all. A good attempt by the Socceroo midfielder, really. From a good, Peter, I would suspect, about 25 metres out.
Great shot, great shot.
Vlado Bozanowski has only scored the one goal in seven internationals for Australia, and that was naturally a goal he'll never forget against Argentina in Sydney. And now Buzz, the header on, and just wide. Well, that was close for Australia, really. Bozanowski had almost done some work at the other end. Paz was on the right here, got the ball inside. It was a nice touch. And the header by Saraligi just wide.
The game's opened up here. Both teams are going at each other.
Well, for a game that's created so many chances, it's surprising there isn't a goal, but I suppose you have to pay credit to the defences and the goalkeepers.
Absolutely, Andy.
Sanchez on for Captain Barrios. Now the player from Danubio, Kanapkis. And that's the other interesting change, I think, in Uruguayan football. The fact that two Montevideo Giants, Nacional and Peñarol, they're not as strong as they used to be, really, because Danubio, De La Vista, Defensa Sporting, they're the sort of teams that have been winning the league in recent years. So it's been starting to spread itself out, the domination of the competition. Well and truly spread amongst all clubs. Adrian Paz will take the corner kick. The knotted on header by Kanapkis. Still, it's there for Uruguay. The clearance had deflected off Tapai. And now it's with Spink. Relief, really, for the Australians. The Coca-Cola Socceroos well and truly in the hunt in this game. Paz. Skillful play from Uruguay. Adrian Paz. Martin Tobin, and it comes off Tobin.
Great cover there, Alex Tobin.
Adrian Paz will take this corner kick. And well, the opportunity fell there for Kanapkis. And it goes out for the goal kick. And as much as we are impressed with Australia's play, the last two or three corners, we haven't really picked up the runners that have come into the box or some of the free players.
No, we don't want to get slack at this stage. I think the change with Martinez coming in for Uruguay has sprung him to life, and Paz is making those runs down the sideline there. they look more dangerous in the second half.
Nil-nil, and just almost 18 minutes into this second half. Somewhat obstructed there. Kanapkis is in the box at the moment. He curls it inside. Phelan comes and takes it ever so well. Good save by the Socceroo keeper.
Great save, Johnny.
Under extreme pressure, John Phelan doing the job for Australia again. In the middle of the park. Paz is free on the right. Paz looks up for support. Now the captain, Barrios. Great play from Uruguay. They've certainly picked up the tempo in the second half. The cross has come in from De Los Santos. And the chance and the goal. Martinez scores for Uruguay. Great execution from the substitutes. What a way to celebrate his introduction to the game. Uruguay lead 19 minutes into this second half. But it was a great move, started off with the likes of Paz and then the cross from De Los Santos. And Martinez picked his spot. 1-0 Uruguay.
That's so unfortunate for Australia. A couple of lapses in concentration by some of the players. A couple of like Paz making a few runs and Barrios coming through the middle there.
Just looking at that replay, you really feel sorry for John Phelan because he was coming out and then he hesitated somewhat. Although no one picked up Martinez and there was three defenders there.
Bit of misunderstanding there.
Van Blur, can Australia come back? They certainly have the character and courage to do so. Well, Uruguay maintain this strong surge that we've seen since the halftime interval.
So unfortunate because we were playing quite well. We had them contained defensively. Such a tragedy.
Van Blurk looks up for support. Wade is there. Can't keep it in though. Australia is a similar situation, you could say, for them. Last Friday against Argentina, they were down 1-0 in the second half. That was actually in the second minute. And Paz has won himself a free kick.
This long tour, Andy, could have taken its toll here. Well, maybe a couple of players a bit tired in the second half. Put so much effort in the first half.
There's been a lot of travelling for the team, as I mentioned earlier in the call. You can imagine after the Uruguay game was called off, they had to head off back to Florida and come back to Argentina. And they had to go en route via Miami and New York in some of those flights. There was delays. But that's part and parcel of travelling overseas. And you talk to some of the players from, say, the 74 World Cup side, like Manfred Schaefer and Johnny Warren, they tell you the circumstances that they had to play internationals overseas are similar, if not worse. As De Los Santos finds Martinez, the scorer, offside flag up against Saraligi. And Saraligi has become a bit of a key player for Uruguay in the second half. He's become more involved in the game and he's been pushing forward and he's given them a new dimension through the middle there.
He's been involved in a lot of their play. Also, there's a bit of loose marking in the middle of the park there.
Well, I feel, Peter, that whatever happens today, Australia can take heart from this performance. I rate this performance better than so far what we've seen, better than the match against the United States, and obviously better than the game against Argentina.
Great performance today. Great performance. We've come forward, we've taken the game to them, we've had opportunities, and, you know, the result, it doesn't matter. I mean, as long as we've created chances and tried to win the game at least, well, that's an encouraging performance.
It's a real learning experience for a lot of these players that haven't toured with the senior team away to South America. I'm not sure that any of the players, except for Wade and Bozanowski, have played South American opposition, because we think of the Gold Cup, and then we go back to 74, the World Cup finals against Chile, and of course before that Uruguay, Saraligi and Marth there, because he was keeping close tabs on the right side of player Buzz, and he came back in. That was a good move, nice touch on. Tapo will keep that in too. Goes behind Van Bloek. Wade, as per usual, he's done a lot of running today. Peterson. Perhaps we haven't seen as much of Peterson in the second half as we did in the first, but Australia have had to do a lot more defending in the second half.
For sure, Andy.
The cross, and the keeper takes it quite easily, and there's no need for the keeper to try and make a meal of it. I don't know why they're standing over the player, really. That's just ridiculous. There's no real need for that. 50-50 ball. Van Bloek went up with the keeper, and because they landed together, the theatrics really irritates me when keepers carry on like that. There's no real need for it.
Bad to see that.
It hasn't been a spiteful game by any means. So 25 minutes are up in this second half. We're in the 70th minute of play. Uruguay lead by 1-0. Martinez, the scorer, in the 64th.
Looks like it's going to come on.
So it looks like it will likely be a straight change with Spink, I would suspect. Well, there's some overzealous tackling going on out in the centre, and the goal scorer, there's a man that looks like Edwards will come on. And it is Spink who's coming off. With just under 20 minutes left, Alistair Edwards gets another opportunity on tour.
Warren Spink, he's had a great game.
He's desperate to be part of the World Cup because he knows the likes of Arnold and Slater will come into contention. And I'm not too sure whether Coach Eddie Thompson would be considering the likes as Peterson. Well, that wasn't far wide at all from Mike Peterson.
Great shot.
And look at the replay of Van Bloek. Got in well, laid it off, and Peterson, the keeper, would have been stranded. I was just saying,
I
don't know whether Coach Eddie Thompson will be looking at the likes of Christodoulou, Kalantzis, Patikas, because they haven't been mentioned, although I think they'd have a lot to contribute to the national team.
For sure, but I don't think so. I think he's rebuilding the team based on these players and Frank Farina, Arnold. I think Jimmy or Chris haven't really played with the Socceroos in the past 3 or 4 years. It'd be hard to mould them into the side at this stage.
Can't help forgetting that game in 85 against Scotland when Patikas came on. He just changed the game right around, and that was a World Cup qualifier where Australia could quite possibly have qualified for Mexico in 86.
Well, we know Jimmy's ability. He's a great player with a lot of speed. And from what they tell me, he's really improved his skills over in Greece.
But the encouraging sign is that Patikas, well, he's a player who played in the youth championships at 17 in 81 and then went to Mexico in 83. But we've got these players coming through the junior ranks, which is really encouraging for Australian football. And a snapshot well off the target. Alex Tobin, there's a player who came through the youth team. Filan, Blagojevic, Zelic.
A lot of great talent there.
Oh, there's plenty. Spink was another. Van Blerk, Edwards. And you could go right through. So it's really been an encouraging 12 months for Australian football overall. But at the moment, it was Paz. And well, it was like the Exocet missile. High and wide. Had plenty of time there. I'm surprised that a player of his class would have elected to go first time when he could have controlled and maybe had a bit of a run and then had the shot on the run.
Absolutely right, Andy, there. Or maybe he could have had a couple more steps and go closer. But there seems to be a few players a little bit tight out there. The game's really opened up here.
Wade in the heels of De Los Santos. Edwards, the fresh legs of Alistair Edwards. Well, see, that's the pressure. The pressure tells. Well, I thought perhaps Bozanowski was clipped. The referee says no. Cabrera to Paz. And given straight to the captain, Paul Wade. Peterson. Good ball inside for Tapai. That right, that appears to be Bozanowski. That's Bozanowski rather than Durakovic.
But this will be a great learning experience for the Socceroos, and I'm pretty sure they'll come out of it better players.
Well, there's 15 minutes left in the game. Australia are down by a goal. Nothing to lose, naturally, to use a cliche. Everything to play for. Not too sure what the delay is. I just don't think they can recover the ball. They have now.
This is the type of opposition I think we'll probably have to play if we do get to the late stage of the World Cup qualifier. So it is a great experience to play such opposition.
I think the next step that if it can be arranged is to bring out a South American national team, play a three-match series here, or bring out another team and play a three-team tournament.
We certainly need more games for the Socceroos in our World Cup qualifiers, because that's the measure. If we can qualify for the World Cup, well, then Australia is really moving on.
Now Edwards leaving it. The ball's a deep one and too deep for Paul Wade. He's covered a lot of ground today, Paul Wade. Do you think overall that Louis Cubilla will be happy with his team's performance so far?
I'm pretty sure, you know, he's got the result. I mean, he's got the goal there. He's got a lot of the European-based players, which I believe he doesn't want. They're not playing, but I'm pretty sure World Cup qualifiers come around. I'm pretty sure these players will be back on in the team. They don't look that impressive, Uruguay.
And of course, he persisted with using the locally based players for the Copa America last year. They had three draws, but they didn't get into the final four. Now Van Blerk, good jinking run. Wade, Van Blerk was taken out by the number two, Daniel Sanchez.
That's a cheeky foul there, cheeky professional foul.
That's what I mean. If Peterson can get a yellow for kicking the ball away, I think that's worthy of a yellow as well. An attacking situation. And you wonder whether the Socceroos will attempt one of those amazing free kicks. Maybe not. It might go deep, looking for Wade to knot it on, or perhaps for Wade to head for goal.
There's Charlie Yankles now.
And it's certainly not the 10 metres at the moment. It's been laid off. And that was Marth.
He's got a good shot on him. Definitely Andrew Marth.
Scored a strong goal 2 years ago in the grand final. The strongest of clearances, although it's with the Uruguayans at the moment. Paz, he was playing for the free kick there. And you can see the conditions out there extremely difficult for the players. It's been raining the last few days. It was raining last night. So the change being made. Diego Dorta, the 15th. 15, rather, is on. He's got 10 minutes to impress his coach. Already the man on the ball has. He's scored the goal that's given them a 1-0 lead, but a good decision by the referee.
Well, we definitely haven't been outplayed in this game, Andy, although the result is 1-0 against us.
In it comes. 10 on the clock, and the free header for Andrew Marth.
What a great
It
chance.
Could have been the equaliser for Australia. With just under 10 to go, Marth knows it as well. The free kick from Peterson. Australia should be level at 1-1.
What an opportunity.
Oh. I think perhaps Marth was surprised with the amount of space and room that he had. He had no one challenging him, really.
I wish we could see the replay of that. I think he was on his own there.
Although, in his defence, I will say that perhaps with the other players going up for it, he might have seen it late coming through. But from that range, you should put those ones away. And we could have had a 1-1 situation here with... Now there's 9 minutes of normal time left.
Well, that's unfortunate. We should have had a goal there.
There's a lot of positives to come out of this game for Australia, though.
Absolutely.
Zalazar, we haven't seen too much of him in the second half. It's been more Paz and Saraligi, but there's the ball. Marth will get there. He doesn't hold back in those sorts of challenges. Andrew Stabber Marth. He was really a shattered man after that grand final. Two grand final losses in a row. Again on penalties.
Yeah. You'd think after the 1-0, after the goal they scored, they'd pick up the tempo, but we're really taking the game to them. And
so the Australians are all getting back. You can hear the call. Jason Van Vleuten's been called back into the penalty area to pick up. And comes a free kick again, looking deep. Violins up. And the referee has spotted Kanapkis's little nudge.
Good decision there.
As they went up, I don't know if they'll replay it, but Kanapkis just got in on John Phelan. Not many people would know that one of the big reasons Folland's had a great season is the fact that when Tony Pisano went down there, he played a few games earlier in the season and he stayed on there and helped David Ratcliffe out, but particularly with the goalkeepers. And Pisano kept Folland on his toes, and that was one of the reasons, obviously, that Folland has been so sharp this year. And before Pisano, obviously Fred Waugh being involved at St George.
Well, I was speaking to Tony recently, and he thinks that John Folland is one of the best keepers that the country has ever produced, and that's a very high opinion by a former Socceroo player.
Well, he always seemed to produce outstanding goalkeepers. Van Blerk will come away. Nice touch inside. Peterson. All in all challenge, but it's with Saraligi. Now Zalazar. Martinez had made the run inside. Saraligi's there at the moment, though. Martha's right on his back. Martinez gets it back, though, for Cabrera. Jurakovic. Edwards' touch, not a really good one because it was well to the left of Peterson. Martinez has made the overlap and the shot on the turn, and what a goal! A superb finish from Larea. That ends it for Australia. But a superb execution from the Central Espanol striker. He won't forget today in a long time at all. Look at this for a finish. 2-0 Uruguay, 5.5 to go.
Just goes to show you how dangerous the Uruguayan team can be. I mean, they put a passage of play together. A great finish by Larea.
It certainly is well worth another replay. The goal scorer earlier, but Inez got it inside, and Ireland had no chance at all.
It's a great finish.
That's one of the best goals you'll see, really. I really am impressed with that one from Larea. On the turn and well low down to the keeper's left. Snuck it in that post. And I really don't think any keeper could have saved that.
No.
Can Australia salvage a consolation? 5 to go, it's 2-0. Could have been 1-1 just moments earlier. Marth in there. And he kept his cool under some pressure too. Well, I'm sure the Uruguayan coach Luis Pubilla will be a relieved man right now, because a draw or a loss to Australia would not be a good result by the high standards that Uruguay do have.
Absolutely, Andy. It's unfortunate. We've lost the ball in the middle of the park there, stupid mistake. And a couple of passes together, and there they are. A goal down. Another goal.
Bosanowski elect to go for goal, or would they look for Marth again? Marth's up there, straight into the wall. Ivanovic, no offsides whatsoever there. Captain Barrios kept his cool just to lay that ball on. It's across now with De Los Santos. Two good goals for Uruguay, particularly that second one from Larea. And that's wrapped up the game, really, for Uruguay. Australia desperate to get on the score sheet. Edwards was held back. That's obviously a yellow against Canapas, but whether it will be is another question. It certainly is. Fernando Canapas goes into the book as well. So three yellow cards in the second half.
this is what happens, the lapse in concentration at the international level, I mean, you get punished.
And Wade, as you can see, was just held onto by Kanapkis. Wade, deflection. Oh, that was so close for Australia, and they really deserved a consolation at least for the efforts today. And Paul Wade was so unlucky there. The ball took a deflection. The keeper was gone, but it was just inches wide.
He certainly deserved a goal.
And now Buzz, Saraligi rather, he ran into Tobin. And the referees allowed the, well, that was a bit unfair, I really honestly thought there, because Tobin was put down and the player ran into him. But anyway, justice in the end, no goals again.
Well, the result does not reflect the way the game is really going today. That's very unfortunate. We've had chances to score goals and we haven't really taken them.
What about the players from this tour? There's obviously a lot of players that have been tested out. The World Cup qualifiers in mind, have all of them stood up to the test?
I think so. I think all of them will come back better players. I'll be better for the oncoming games.
You don't think they'll make more changes at all?
I don't know. I mean, I'm not in a position to say, but I think the boys are going quite well. I mean, Tapai and Spink, and midfield Bozanowski today, he did quite well. Miggy Peterson was involved. Paul Wade has had a good game. I think overall, it's been a good performance today.
And there's the chance again for Australia, and they couldn't take advantage. Well, credit to the Australians, they haven't given up the fight. It was just on 20 seconds of normal time. Wade was in there yet again.
Poor Wade, he hasn't stopped trying. He's leading by example.
Good nod on by Van Blerk. Wade's in there again. The numbers are back for Uruguay. Tapai, good turn inside. It was a handball, the referee didn't pull it up, allowed sure, the advantage. Yes. The keeper takes it well. Good save by Siboldi. Now Uruguay, they had the numbers, but you've got to pay praise to the Australians.
It's a great ball.
Now Peterson. Tapai. Jurakovic rather, he went on just a tad too long with it. Playing stoppages. 2-0 Uruguay. Zalazar. And look at the space on this left-hand side. Larea, the man who scored the goal, to make it 2. Zalazar off Martho. And John Fylan, will he keep it in? He should, and he does. There's a bit of a Higuita. And that could almost cost him, though. Martinez. And headed away by Marth. Australia defending and defending with everything. And I suspect that will be about it. We didn't really have that many stoppages in the second half. But Uruguay lead 2-0. Peterson on for Tapai. But great touches close in. Unbelievable. That is the most amazing finish to a game I've ever seen. Tapai thought he was on his way. The referee pulled off a superb save to collect the ball.
I think Eddie Thompson would be very happy with this performance today.
But 2-0, Australia, it could have been 1-1. It could have been any scoreline. Australia had their chances. Uruguay took theirs. Australia, a tad unlucky. The crossbar denied them in the first half. There was opportunities throughout. The tour finishes, though, started off 1-0, a victory against the United States, and then against Argentina, a 2-0 loss. They held their own. It was 0-0 at half-time, a controversial decision early in the second half, although Argentina were a superior side. And today, they've held their own against Uruguay, no doubts about that. They can walk off with their heads held high
I'm sure that Louis Cubilla will have a lot to say to his team, despite the 2-0 score.
We've certainly taken the game to him. We've had a lot more possession. We've created chances, and it was good to see. Very encouraging.
Uruguay's last victory was against Brazil in April at the same stadium, the Estadio Centenario in Montevideo. So 1-0 against Brazil, today against Australia, they finish on top 2-0. The tour ends for Australia, but it ends on really, in my eyes, on a high note. So the final scoreline here, Uruguay 2, Australia 0. We'll cross now to Les Murray.
Thank you, Andy. And that victory over Brazil by Uruguay was achieved by much the same players, the European-based players of Uruguay, even then refusing to play for their coach, Luis Cubilla. So, Raul, a good performance by Australia, a really high one to finish the tour on. Uruguay stronger in the second half, really.
Yes.
But Australia, an excellent game overall.
I think that Uruguay deserved the victory, but very encouraging performance by Australia. Those are the type of opponents we will have to face on the way to the World Cup, and I think it will be a great experience, and valuable experience really for the players to know how to deal with this type of football. And I think as the tour went on, the team looked better and better. It means I think that now the series against the Croatian national team are going to show that we can keep improving.
The lessons learned?
Lessons learned is against this type of opposition that you have to be very careful with the ball, and I think that just a little bit more aggressive at time in the physical department. I think that they are aggressive in their own soil or whatever they are. But I think all in all, as the tour progresses, we show really that we are getting closer and closer, and we're closing the gap really.
John, what do you think Eddie Thompson has learned on the tour, from a positive or negative sense? In what sense is he wiser now?
Well, I think that we're all wiser because of the fact that you just can't make any half chance. It is penalised at that level. We saw it against Argentina. We saw it today. But I think they could feel well pleased with the performance, particularly today. They were in the game the whole time. But perhaps looking ahead to World Cup time, it's not sufficient to lose 2-0 away from home and expect to go through. My only comment on the whole tour really is that it should have perhaps been a little bit longer with more games. Sure, they've benefited from playing Argentina and Uruguay, but to have had more experience would have been a better situation for them.
Well, I think there was a lot of things learned. I mean, he's tried players out. He knows now how they can stand up to these sort of games. Vlado Bozinovski, Milan Blagojevic playing two games, didn't he, in that right back position. So there's, I'm sure he's found out a lot of things, Raul.
Yes, this is the time for trial and error. I think that World Cup is still, elimination are not too far away. But I think this is the type of things you have to experience. You have to feel which will be your final selection when the time comes. And I think it was very important to see. I think Eddie was clever to give everybody a chance. And I think when he come back, he will know by then who are the ones who will go on with the job and the ones who maybe will not.
Okay, John, Raul, thank you for joining us. Raul, thanks for your good help. And thank you. You're off to sleep now. You're out to do a few jogs with the boys.
Yes, I have to.
Yeah. Okay, Raul, thank you. And that's another night of soccer, leaving us now only to wind up to the climax of Euro 92. We're here again tomorrow morning with the second semi-final, Netherlands versus Denmark, live beginning at 3:45 Eastern Time. From Gothenburg, a replay of this morning's match in edited form tonight at 5 to 11. And then the final, Saturday morning again at 3:45 Eastern Time. But till tomorrow morning, thank you for joining us from the World Game. Goodbye.
It
was Hans van Breukelen. Ruud Hullet is a tad darker. Meantime, Australia has completed its tour of the Americas with a 2-0 defeat to Uruguay in Montevideo. The Socceroos were not daunted by the two-time World Cup winners in what turned out to be the most entertaining game of the three-match tour.
Australia had made five changes for the final encounter, and Oliru goalie John Fyland was one of them.
It's like a lovely save by John Fyland.
After the early scare, Australia put together an enterprising build-up before captain Paul Wade was denied by the Uruguayan goalie and the crossbar. The match was only 5 minutes old, and the Socceroos' intentions were very clear. And just 4 minutes later, right back Mehmet Jurakovic caused another scare in the Uruguayan defence.
Mehmet Jurakovic looking for support.
At the other end, though, an uncharacteristic error allowed Alejandro Larrea through, but once again, Fyland was well placed.
Although an uncharacteristic error, and Fyland got down well to deny.
Just before half-time, the visiting defence was again tested. But this time, newly promoted defender Andrew Marth kept Uruguay out.
And the header was off target.
The second half was much similar to the first, both teams desperate for the breakthrough.
Just wide too.
In the 58th minute, Mike Peterson supplied Warren Spink with a good pass, but the Preston striker found it tough getting past the home team goalkeeper.
He has enough meat behind it.
Australia's European-based midfielder, Vlado Bozanowski, had a busy game, and he also tested his luck in the second half.
Bozanowski tries his luck, and it wasn't too far wide at all.
But it was Uruguay who had the best opportunity, with Marcelo Saralegui squandering a good chance.
Just wide.
The goal the home fans had so desperately wanted finally came in the 64th minute, with Sergio Martinez the scorer.
And the chance and the goal! Martinez scores for Uruguay.
The Australian defence had no one but themselves to blame for giving Martinez room in the penalty area.
And Martinez picked his spot.
Undeterred, Australia maintained the pressure. They were playing enterprising football, but continually had nothing to show for it. There was a glimmer of hope with just 10 minutes to play. Marth could have been the hero, but somehow he headed the ball over with the goal at his mercy. Australia paid for the miss with just 6 minutes left. What a goal it was from Larrea.
Martinez has made the overlap and the shot on the turn, and what a goal!
Anything less than a win would have been embarrassing for Uruguay, who've won a record 14 South American championships. Such was Australia's luck that a cross from hard-working captain Paul Wade took a nasty deflection and went just inches wide.
Oh, that was so close for Australia!
Credit to the Australians, though, they didn't give up, and despite the loss, it was a good finish to their three-match tour.
And there's the chance again for Australia, and they couldn't take advantage.
The team was due back in Sydney this morning after their tour of North and South America. The flight has been delayed in Buenos Aires, and the team will now arrive at 10 o'clock this evening. And by the way, Socceroo Nedzelic will play for German club Borussia Dortmund next season after a transfer fee of $600,000 was agreed upon with Zelic's NSL club Sydney Olympic. Zelic will join his new club after the Barcelona Olympics. Been given the vacant position in the Coca-Cola Soccer League. The vacancy was declared earlier this month because of financial problems with Sydney club Apia Leichhardt. Morwell Falcons won the spot ahead of Leichhardt Tigers, the privately backed side organised by Apia president Ron Orsatti.
It was just 2 weeks ago when Ron Orsatti was confident his bid would be successful.
Well, I think it'll be an hard battle, but I think probably, as they say, I've got to make a good proposal and maybe make an offer they can refuse, you know.
Pouring the glass.
But today, Morwell Falcons had...